boundary conditions, we discretize the initial conditions and interior this equation for interior points and boundary conditions. Okay, boundary conditions. So we need to discretize everything. Okay, here also we need to discretize this. So if we have discretized these governing equations, we need to discretize this boundary initial conditions as well as boundary conditions also. Okay. So that is the main concept. So of discretization, everything need to be discretized for n. So in this case, this is n is equals to 0 plus, but boundary conditions is always n plus 1. Okay. Why n plus 1? Because you see, if you go to this particular point, this region, for example, here the characteristic passing through this point is like this. Okay. But you see, since there is a boundary, this particular point is not there. So the point is here. Okay. So you see, at this boundary, at this case, only initial conditions are there for all i's. Okay. So for I is equals to 0, some initial condition is given. For I is equal to 1, initial condition. So for all these points, you have already initial condition at n is equals to 0. But at n is equals to 1, that is n is equals to n plus 1, n is equals to n plus 1, we have a boundary condition at the left. So that is the reason most of the cases, these are n plus 1th level boundary conditions. Okay. Okay. So we did discretization for that, and for interior points also, we organize this equation into the n plus 1 unknown time value, and nth level values are known values. Okay. So general notation in CFD, general notation, or it depends upon the people also, n means the current level, okay, or known level, known time level value, time level value. Okay. And n plus 1 means unknown time level value. Okay. So that is how. So in terms of unknown, you can express all the known. So you go like this. And if you want to do this, then you can essentially, excuse me, do for n is equal to 0, n is equals to 1. Okay, same thing can be done for n is equals to 1. So here the changes will happen. For n is equals to 1, this will become 2. Okay, and this will become 1, 1, 1. Isn't it? Okay, so this will become for n is equals to 1, this will become 2, this will become 1, this 1 and 1, and this will become 2. Okay, similarly, and for all i means I running from 1 to n, not 0. I is equals to 0, we have boundary condition. So I is equals to 0, for I is equals to 0, we have boundary condition. Similarly, we can go for n is equals to 2, n is equals to 3, n is equals to 4, 5, till you get the proper solution, okay, converse solution. Okay, so that is how the algorithm is. So I'll just write an algorithm to solve this problem. Okay, algorithm is a pseudo code basically. Pseudo code is not actually a code. Algorithm means sequential sets of instructions. Sequential set of instructions. Okay, that is, you know. Sequential sets of instruction, that is, or sometime we called as pseudo code. Okay, so it is not actually pseudo code, not actually written in any programming language, not written. Pseudo code is something which is not written in any programming language. Okay, so what we can do, first thing first is we have to initialize. Okay, so give the initial condition or prescribe the initial condition. Okay, what is the initial condition? Initial condition was you x0 that was at any I, that was some function u of x. Okay, it was some function u of x, and that was also I. So this is for all I means I running from 0, 1, 2 up to last point. N means last point. So for all the points, grid points, special points, we have to give this initial condition. Once you have given this initial condition, we can start your solution with this initial condition and move to the interior nodes. Okay, so the second thing is interior nodes. Okay, for interior nodes, so we have to solve this equation. What is the equation? Ui n plus 1 is equals to ui n minus a delta t delta x ui n minus ui minus 1 n. Okay, this has to be solved for I 1 2 3 up to n. Okay, so not I is equals to 0. Okay, not I is equals to 0. For I is equals to 0, already we have initial condition. Okay, so this is for all this thing. Okay, I point, and then what do you do is, next thing is the boundary conditions. Okay, so next thing is boundary condition. Boundary condition. Okay, and this boundary condition, type of boundary condition was given, you left at x is equals to 0 and at all the times was given as some ul of time, ul as a function of time was given. So t was a given. So this is also for I. This is for I, but this for I is equals to for I is equals to 0. That is our boundary. I is equals to 0 is a boundary. And this has to be calculated at n plus 1 and n plus 1. Okay. So this has to be done for 1 n, for one time. Then we have to repeat. Okay. So once you have calculated this one, next step is you substitute. Next step is substitute n is equals to n plus 1. Okay. And keep on moving in nth direction, time. Okay. For n is equals to n plus 1. Okay. Repeat. Repeat. 2 and 3. Okay. Till the desired solution is achieved. Till the desired solution is achieved. Okay. So desired solution means the solution which will be converse solution. So it the converse solution is the one which will not change with time later on. Okay, so whatever it is, it was at n minus 1, it will be at nth location, or it will be at n plus 1th location. So if such a situation comes, in that case, you have to stop the solution. So generally, we can specify some n number, maybe 100 or something, and then we can see if the solution, or you can use some while do loop, condition loop, and check whether the solution is differing from previous iteration or not. So previous time step, okay. So from previous time step to current time step, is there any variation or not, that you should check. And once you check and see that the difference is very, very small, like 10 to the power minus 6 or something, then it is very close to 0. So you can stop your simulations and print the values of all u values at all I. Okay. So achieved. Okay. And if it is achieved, okay, print. Print UI. Okay. UI. So I is running from all points to last point. Up to last point for I. Print all these values. And this has to be printed. So this is your solution. This is your final solution at the converse time step, converse time. Okay, so you have to follow this this thing. Okay, so initialize the solution, then here you will have to do some for loop, do while loop or something like do while loop. Under do while loop, this, because this 2 and 3 has to be repeated, so this will go in a like a loop. So here you will have to do some sort of do while looping. Okay. And inside do while loop, then you will have to have a for loop which will run from 1 to n and will calculate u n plus 1 values. And then simply for I is equals to 0, you have to update the value of boundary condition. Okay. And boundary condition updation, then again you have to repeat those things in do while loop. Okay. So after do while loop is over, then you have to print the values of UI. Okay, this is how the algorithm is. Now having this algorithm at your hand, and say you have been given a problem. Now for example, you have been given a problem, same problem, del u del t, okay, plus a del u del x is equals to 0. Okay. Now this is example problem. For example is given where a is equals to 1 is given, okay, and your x location is say 10, and now this is non-dimensional, so there is no unit, for example, so we'll say just 10. Okay, x is 10, and okay, so like this, and boundary conditions are given. say you have a left boundary. So you at x is equals to 0 and all any other time you have suppose been given boundary condition sine of t. Okay, and initial condition is given at any x but t is equals to 0. You can say t is equals to 0. You can write like t is equals to 0. You can have sine x. Okay, so if you want to solve this problem using this algorithm, you can do that. Okay, and for this case, there is an analytical solution. Analytical solution is required to compare. So analytical solution is u is a function. Now it will be a sine x minus t. That is your solution. So solution looks like the sine wave. Okay, the solution looks like, so for example, this is your x direction. So solution, suppose you have been given a sine value, so through x, so it will be suppose like this. So this is the initial condition, so all solution will be like this, but they will be moving with a is equals to 1. So they will move with a is equals to 1 in time, but the solution will look like this. Okay, so sine wave is a solution, so it has to be like that. So say for example, after you discretize, you need delta t, delta x, a is already we have seen said that one, and say delta x we would like to take 1. Okay, so delta x, say delta x is 1. Delta x is 1. Delta x is 1 means you are dividing x length into 10 segments. Okay, so it means you have n is equals to number of points 10. Okay, number of points 10. If you calculate with 0, then it will be 9. Okay, so say total number of points 10, starting with I is equals to 1. Okay, so delta x is 1, and in such cases, if you solve for different delta t, suppose you have delta t point 0 1, and you have 0.1, and you have suppose 1, and you have 2, 3, like that. Okay, you can take many delta t's. Okay, there can be many choices of delta t's. Now for the special case of delta t's, suppose you have delta t. Delta t is equals to, suppose you have delta t, suppose you have delta t, suppose you have delta t equals to 1. Now in such cases, you have delta a delta t delta x, that will become 1. A product of a delta t delta x, because everything is 1, so that will become 1. Okay, so this product will completely become 1. Okay, and in such cases, you get a solution of this type. You get a solution of this type. What is the solution you get? I'll just try to draw. Okay, so at delta t is equals to 1, and your actual solution is, excuse me, your actual solution is already sine wave, right? That is your original solution. Original solution is your sine wave solution. Okay, so your original solution, your analytical solution is sine wave solution. Now for a delta t numerical solution, what about numerical solution? So numerical solution will also be following on these points. सो न्यूमेरिकल सॉल्यूशन विल बी एक्यूरेट, न्यूमेरिकल सॉल्यूशन विल बी एक्यूरेट. एक्स रिप्रेजेंट्स न्यूमेरिकल सॉल्यूशन, न्यूमेरिकल न्यूमेरिकल सॉल्यूशन. ओके, एंड लाइन रिप्रेजेंट्स अ कंटिन्यूअस लाइन, कंटिन्यूअस लाइन रिप्रेजेंट्स एनालिटिकल सॉल्यूशन. दिस इज एनालिटिकल, एनालिटिकल सॉल्यूशन. सो इन दिस वेरी स्पेसिफिक केस व्हेन डेल्टा टी इज इक्वल्स टू वन एंड फॉर द फिक्स्ड वैल्यू ऑफ डेल्टा एक्स एंड ए वी गेट एग्जैक्ट सॉल्यूशन. बट देयर कैन बी अनदर टू एक्सट्रीम्स. सो फॉर एग्जांपल यू हैव अ डेल्टा टी, सपोज यू हैव अ डेल्टा टी लेस देन वन, दैट इज से लेस देन वन. सो से डेल्टा टी इज, से डेल्टा टी इज 0.1. इन सच केसेस यू हैव अ सोल्यूशन, यू गेट अ सोल्यूशन. ओके, एंड फॉर विच यू, एक्सक्यूज मी, for which again the analytical solution is already known to us, and that is a sine. Okay, that is a sine. But when delta t is less than 1, your other solution, that is numerical solution, numerical solution will look like this. Your numerical solution will look like this. It means if you draw a, if you have a, many other points, your curve so here you see the amplitude, there is a decrease in amplitude. Okay, so here there is a decrease in amplitude, decrease in amplitude. In the beginning the amplitude was fairly well, but later locations there is a decrease in amplitude. Okay, so such a nature is called as dissipative nature. Okay, so such a nature is a dissipative type. Okay, so the numerical solution shows a dissipative nature at what values of delta t? At delta t 0.1. Suppose there is another situation, delta t is greater than 1. So say delta t is 1, delta t is 2 for example. Okay, now in such situation what will be your solution? So the solution looks like this. I'll just draw it again. This you can check by writing this program and plotting these solutions. You will come to know the discrepancy of this. So this is a homework. You please do at your home, write a code in any programming language you wish and solve this case. You will get the results what I'm trying to show here. So you might get like this. Okay, so what do you see here? There is sudden increase in the amplitude. Okay, so increase in the amplitude, increase in the amplitude. In the amplitude. Okay, such a nature is is dispersive. Okay, dispersive means your solution will keep on increasing in its amplitude, and at one point of time your solution will blow up. Solution will blow up, will blow up. Okay, and your program or computer screen will show nan. Okay, not a number. So such a kind of values will start coming. Nan, not a number, like that. It will start coming. Okay, so you will get such a kind of error. Okay, so what do you see from this? So there is a certain choice of delta t. There is a certain choice of delta t for which your solution either go in one extreme where it will start decreasing in its amplitude, or it will show dissipative nature, okay, dissipation in the solution, or it will show growth in the amplitude of the solution, or it will show dispersive nature of the solution, and the solution will blow up, okay, and suddenly will start getting not a number. Okay, so out of this extreme cases, the best one is which following this the proper choice of delta t. So what do you understand from this is that there is a choice of delta t for which we are going to get a proper solution. This solution is of no use because it is giving us a nan. It is not going to give us any solution. So this type of solution is of no use. Okay, however, we would like either to have, this is the very best solution, but if you get this solution, we would like to improve this solution. Okay, by some condition or something. Okay, so we would like to improve. So this is a second choice, but this is a better choice. Okay, but it does it mean that for all delta t it will happen everywhere in any other problems? No, it is happening for this particular problem only. Okay, this special case is happening for this particular case only. Okay, and why it is happening, the reason lies in the equation, governing equation. Okay, now when you have a delta t delta x, both all are like one, so this whole term is getting one. Okay, now when this is one, what do you see is that these terms un uin uin will get cancel out, and this minus minus will become plus, and you see uin plus one value, which is, so suppose you have a grid here, you have grid points here, and ui, this, suppose this is ith point, and you have ui minus one point, okay, and which is at nth level, and there is another level, so same points will be there in another level, and I, so this is n plus 1. So what do you see, ui at n plus 1, so ui at n plus 1, this value is equals to this value, isn't it? This value is equals to this value, and this both these values they fall on same characteristic. Both these values fall on same characteristics. Okay, there will be another characteristic like that. So this, if this is ith point, this will be, so that is the reason we are getting exact solution, because these both the points at this condition, a delta t delta x, one uin value, nth value, n plus one value becomes equals to this ui minus 1 nth value, and that is the reason we get exact solution at delta t is equals to 1 for the chosen values of a 1 and delta x is equals to 1. Okay, So when you get such a kind of answer, okay, from any scheme means whatever the finite FT BS. So all, in all cases, we have done FT BS, FT, you know, like that. Okay, so in for every cases we seen that now we have a restriction on that restriction on delta t. So this particular solution is called as unstable solution. Okay, unstable because it is not stable, it blows up, so unstable. So this is called as unstable solution. Okay, so this is unstable solution, right? So this is unstable solution. This solution is at least stable. Okay, this is at least stable, it doesn't blow, it might get diffused, but at least stable. So this is a stable solution and this is also stable solution. Okay, but the scheme we have used is FT BS, forward in time and backward in space. Okay, even though the discretization is proper, even though the discretization is proper, we can come across with some sort of stable or unstable limits. Okay, we can come across with stable or unstable limits. Okay, so that is what we are trying to say. So what do we, let me just add new page. So I think I'll stop this. And we can start the new one. Okay. So what do you see, that there is something called as instability and stability involved in a discretization. Okay, so we can have a proper discretization, but there is a problem of the discretization we have a problem of instability. ओके, सो वी हैव अ प्रॉब्लम ऑफ इंस्टेबिलिटी. So one scheme we seen that we seen one scheme, okay, that was our forward in time and backward in space. Okay, there can be any other scheme. Okay, so any scheme which do not increase the any scheme which do not blow up the solution is called as stable scheme. Okay, and any scheme which do blow up the solution, it will be called, so I'll just write formally, maybe it is a repetition, but I'll write any scheme which blow up, blows up the solution, is called as unstable scheme. Unstable scheme. Okay, now we have two schemes. One is called as stable and another one is called as unstable. Okay, but in one case we have seen that even though the scheme is stable, it can be stable under certain constraints. Okay, so stable schemes can be of two types. One is called as conditionally stable. What does mean by the conditionally stable? If you satisfy certain conditions, if you satisfy certain condition such a way that the solution do not blow up, then it is conditionally stable. Okay, so under certain conditions or conditions, only if the solution do not blow up, okay, then it is called as conditionally stable. There is another one which is called as unconditionally stable. Okay, unconditionally stable. So it means that there is no restriction or no condition. Okay, for any values of delta t, delta x, a, you do not have blow up in the solution. Okay, so it is unconditionally stable. Similarly, unstable scheme are conditionally unstable or unconditionally unstable. Okay, but these are useless. Unstable schemes are useless. Okay, so they are useless, so no need to think of that. unstable schemes are useless. No need to think about them. Okay, useless. So we want a stable scheme. And if the scheme is unconditional, conditionally stable, then we have a restriction. We should be careful to follow this conditionality. Unconditional stable, there is no condition, so no need to worry. But we need to worry about conditionally stable scheme. Okay. So what are these conditionality limits, and this thing will be a part of our discussion. Okay, and that what are the conditional stability limits? This is a part of which is called as, okay, finding out the conditionality limit is called as stability analysis. Okay, that is called as stability analysis. Okay, and there is one famous method of stability analysis is called as von Neumann stability analysis. Von Neumann stability analysis. Okay, that is called as von Neumann stability analysis. Okay. Okay, so why do the solution blows up at delta t and some values of delta x? Okay, so why the solution blows up? Okay, so why the question, we'll see the von Neumann stability analysis later, but now let us say why the solution blows up. The solution blows up. Okay. For certain values of delta t, delta x, a, delta t, delta x, you know, it starts blowing up. Why it is happening like this? Okay. So when the solution blows up means error grows. Okay. Error grows. Okay. So when error starts growing, then it becomes unstable. If the error grows, keep on growing, then it becomes unstable. If error is within certain limit, because of, then you can control the stability. Okay. So error grows. Okay. Blows means error grows at certain values. Okay. So where from this error comes? So we say that error grows. Okay. At delta d blows up means, it means that error grows. Error grows. What are the sources of errors? What are the sources of errors? Sources of errors. Okay. So one source is called as truncation error. Truncation error. Okay. What is truncation error? Whenever you have any PDE, suppose you had this PDE, del u by del x, what do? You convert this PDE to algebraic equations. What was the algebraic equation? Either it is a forward difference, backward difference, or central difference, right? So say we had this I plus 1 minus ui like that, and delta x is our difference. but we have seen that when we take ui plus 1 minus ui from Taylor series, we get some other terms here, right? You get some other terms here, isn't it? You get some other terms. So here you will get some terms along with this. You will get some terms of this nature, you know, d2 u dx2 and delta x. Delta x is there, so delta x now, and 2 factorial, so 2, and like that you will get d3 u, del x 3, del x 2, and 3 factorial, so 6, and like that. Okay, so what are these? Okay, so this is your PDE, and this is your finite difference expression, FDE. Okay, finite difference expression. Okay, finite. What happened? Okay, so I think I lost that first page. So we had first truncation error. Okay, where from this truncation error comes? So suppose you have a PDE like this. So as I said, and you are using some difference expression. So ui and delta x, and you will get some terms of this nature, del x square, del x by 2 minus del 3 u, del x 3, del x 2 by 6 minus other terms. Okay, so this first term, as I said, first term was, this first term is PDE, partial differential equation. Okay, one part of the part, component, and this expression is finite difference expression, finite difference expression, and whatever this, okay, this term was called as error term. Okay, so this is called as truncation error term. So truncation error term, okay, this is what truncation error, okay, truncation error, T, truncation error, got it? This is called as truncation error. Okay, so when you substitute, you have this error. Now this error depends upon the order of this. Okay, suppose you do not have this term, and it first leading term is delta x square, which one will be better? Suppose you have two expressions, which one will be better? Whichever will have a higher power. Okay, so order of, suppose you have order of delta x and you have order of delta x square scheme, any scheme. Okay, this is a scheme number 1, for example, and number 1, and suppose this is hash 2, number 2. So which one is having a less error? Okay, this one is having less error. Okay, less error compared to the previous one, because suppose error in delta x is 0.1, point square of 0.1, 0.1 is lesser, smaller value. So error will be, total error will be small. Okay, because it's again multiple of that and that, so total truncation error will be small with higher order scheme. Okay, so this error comes because of this truncation of the terms. When you convert any PDE into FDE, we get error terms. Those are called a truncation error terms. So these truncation error terms depend upon delta x. Suppose you, if you have this, only you have this scheme and you do not have this, we said that this scheme is good. But suppose we do not have this, suppose we do not have this, and we have this, suppose we have this, suppose we have only this, we have only this, we have this, then how do we ensure how to minimize truncation error? How to minimize truncation error? By minimizing delta x, by minimizing delta x, okay, by minimizing delta x, or choosing the small value, by choosing the small value of choosing delta x small, okay. So by choosing small delta x, you can get the truncation error less, okay. But the truncation error will be there because of the truncation of the other terms, okay. So instead of having this along with this, all these terms, we have just removed these terms and said that this is our finite difference expression for del u by del x. So that is now gone, okay. There is another type of error. There is another type. What's, how much is the time I have? Oh, I think we crossed the time, but let me just finish with this, okay. Let me just finish with this error, please bear with me. So there is another called as a round off error, okay. Round off error, okay. What is round off error? Whenever we do computations, so whenever we do computations on computer, okay, so we get these errors because computers have some finite precision. These are called as finite precision devices. Finite precision is there, okay. Finite precision is there. Like you have a 64-bit system, you have 32-bit system, okay. So if you have any value, which is, say, you have any value of this nature, 0.33333333333, okay. So this is 1 by this thing, right, 1 by 3. So you may have many, many numbers, but depending on the memory size, it will either choose certain number of terms and will discard other number of terms, because in the memory it can store these terms only, okay. So I'm not drawing exactly according to the bit of that, but suppose this is a bit, particular bit, then it will truncate these terms, it will remove these terms. So instead of removing, what they do, they round it off, okay. So they just round it off and put it here. So because of rounding off, there is an error involved in the computations, inbuilt in the computations, okay. So this round off error is coming from the computer, but this truncation error is coming from the scheme we are using. And to minimize that, we have to use delta x very small. And to remove this round off error, we have to use highly precise systems, highly precise computers. But any highly precise computers is going to be again finitely precise system. So you cannot do this thing. So what we cannot get out of this. So we have to find out some solution for it, okay. And what is the property of this? Suppose there is now one basic property involved in here. Suppose you take very small delta x. If you take very small delta x, mean, for example, suppose you have a region and you have a grids initially. So in this case, your delta x was different. Now, what you mean to say, you want to reduce the delta x, means you have to increase number of nodes. So you have to refine the grid. When you refine the grid, and solution is calculated at every grid point, so your grid points increases. So when your grid points n increases, so what does it mean? round of error also will increase because many computations are happening, many multiplications, divisions are happening. So round of error will also increase. Okay. So what happens? Delta x decreases, truncation error decreases, but round of error increases. Okay, error increases. So there is a fight between these two. So in order to elevate one problem, we are trying to get another problem. So say we have suppose we plot like that, then suppose you have this x and we have truncation error and this thing. So suppose you have very small delta x, then your truncation error will be small, and if your delta x is high, it will be, and you have small delta x, your round off error will be high, and your delta x is high, then round off error will be less. Okay, and at some point these two, suppose this is round off error and this is truncation error, then at some point, at some delta x, they will, okay, there will be an optimum. This is called as optimum delta x. Okay, delta x optimum. Okay, so this finding out delta x optimum is a whole and sole task of, it is called as greed independence test. Greed independence. Okay, this is, you always heard all those fourth year students who are going through this project seminars, people are asking for whether you have a greed independent solutions or not. So that is what. So if you decrease below it, you will not get solution. If you increase below it, also your solution, but there is one optimum greed which will have a greed, means delta x delta y delta g, right? Now we are taking only 1D case, so we are saying optimum greed. Okay, so we have to make choice between these two. So there will be some optimum delta x, which is called as greed independence. Okay, greed independent delta x. Okay, so greed the objective of greed independence is to find out the compromise between round off error and truncation error. Okay, so it means that you do not have error in the solution, so your greed independent solutions are supposed to be correct solutions, okay, supposed to be good solutions, quality solutions. Okay, so this is for today's class. In tomorrow's class, we will look at the what do you call von Neumann stability analysis in order to find out restriction on delta t. Okay, what is the restriction on delta t? Okay, thank you.